Penguin Audio presents Traveler, written and read by Ron McLarty. January 6, 2001. Dear Jono, I am writing to tell you that Marie has passed away. I know she would want you to know, as she always mentioned your Christmas cards. I was with Sis and her husband Chip and their kids a few days before New Year's. She took a nap and did not wake up. Her funeral was 2 days ago, and Mass was at St. Martha's. I have enclosed her Mass card. Father Gallo buried her in a very nice service. We do not know why she has left us. Rhode Island requires an autopsy, but we haven't heard anything yet. I am so sorry to tell you such sad news. How are you? My mother is still alive and is 87 years old. God bless her. Your old pal, Cubby D'Agostino. Chapter 1. In 1961, I fell wildly in love with Marie D'Agostino. She was tall and graceful and had a smell that was as if she had just toweled off after a bath in rose water. Her skin was a shiny light olive, and while everybody else in her family had this Sicilian peasant thing working, Marie always seemed smoothly elegant and gracile. I vividly remember her long fingers and how she would rub them through her amazing, curly, ink-black hair. Her neck, like her arms and legs, was long, and you could see that she had to concentrate to keep her head high. When she got excited about something, which was quite often, her head would bob around madly. Even that was lovely. It was that one little comma in her otherwise perfect countenance. But the thing that caught me, hexed me, engulfed me, really, was her deep, round voice. It seemed to roll out of her small mouth and burst onto your face. And it was to that full, sober, and dependable sound, more than any other facet of this astonishing human being, that I have compared all women since. In 1961, Marie was nearly 12 years old, and whatever happened to her happened quickly, because I noticed she was suddenly different, and as I said, I fell hard. I was an 11-year-old porker from the mixed section of East Providence, specifically Cardinal Avenue, behind the Foundry and two blocks away from St. Martha's Catholic Church. At that time, I ran with Marie's brother Cubby, their cousin Billy Fontanelli, and Bobby Fonts, who was a Portuguese, but that was okay with us. We'd walk to places together and generally mess around. It was pretty good, and the rules were simple. Cubby was sort of the leader because he looked older than the rest of us, even if he wasn't, and because at 11 he already sported pegged pants and a modified Mondo flat top with high crew cut and swept back vitalicized sides. He also had access to Marlboro cigarettes, which we preferred. It was early fall, I remember, and I'd just gotten my traditional back-to-school flat-top rah-rah haircut, which I felt made me appear thinner for some reason, even though several photographs of me from that period show what looks to be a sack of flour with ears. We were watching Bilko with Cubby's old man, Big Tony, and it just happened. I smelled something, and I decided it was roses. I actually smelled her before she walked into the room. She was with her mother, and they'd just come home from the outlet company in Providence buying her school stuff. She had on red corduroy bib overalls, over a checkerboard long-sleeved cotton blouse, and brand-new black Chuck Taylor high-top sneakers. The ensemble was set off by a red comb in her hair. I about had a stroke. She said something to Billy. I think she asked if his sister, one of her girlfriends, was going to Catholic Youth Organization that night. I think that's what she said. I can't be sure because, for the first time since I knew her, I noticed that voice. It was like an echo down a well, a voice that hung around the room even after she had stopped talking. I stood up tall and tried to suck myself inside me so I would appear thinner. I also looked over her head, a technique someone had told me would add age and a certain maturity. Marie D'Agostino paused. It was as if time were frozen for a split second. Those black pearl eyes beheld no one else but me. Her voice was slow, solid, and acute.
"Why don't you take a picture, Riley?" she boomed.
Yeah, that was me, all right. Jono Riley. No middle name, not for the Rileys. We were first and last namers only. According to my old pop, there was a constant unbroken chain of John O'Reillys dating back several centuries before the birth of Christ. Which made sense to me, as pyramid building, especially the part where you pulled huge blocks of stone with rope and then died, was not unlike the kind of work the Rhode Island Rileys specialized in. But from that initial pertinent exchange with her, I could think of nothing else, imagine nothing more wonderful than to be somehow included in the all-encompassing orbit of Marie. I lived just around the corner from the D'Agostinos, but to the geniuses who had drawn up the elementary school grids, I might as well have lived in Seekonk, Massachusetts. Marie was starting sixth grade at Kent Heights, and I was assigned the Brightridge School, about a mile down Pawtucket Avenue. It didn't take Einstein to figure out that if I had any chance at all of impressing myself on her, it would have to come at CYO and weekends with Cubby. I hit upon a strategy of consistency. By being around consistently, I found it was difficult for Marie to avoid the occasional social interaction with me. For example, along with the CYO, which met on Tuesday and Sunday nights, I found that by walking to school a roundabout way, cutting in back of the foundry and up Chester Street, then over to Canton and up King Philip Street, I was able to casually saunter past Ken Heights at the exact moment that Marie and Cubby were walking to school from their house.
"What's going on?"
I'd say to Cubby. It was important at that time to coolly not acknowledge Marie at all. "What's going on?" Cubby would reply. Marie usually looked bored.
"Bozo,"
she'd say if she said anything. Bozo was the nickname that their father, Big Tony, had given me. Big Tony gave everyone nicknames. Billy Fontanelli's nickname was Big Billy, and Bobby Fonse's was Bobberino, and I was Bozo. Her mother used to call me Riley. She also used to like to say, I had the life of Riley. Anyway, I don't remember much about anything, really, so let me get right to that important day, 2 days after Christmas, 1961. There was a lot of snow on the ground from a blizzard on Christmas Eve. Some of the high school kids had gone down to Kent Woods, which was behind the Kent Heights School, and shoveled off Kent Pond and set up the hockey rink. The hockey rink had been set up on the same spot for as long as anyone could remember. My old man had played there, and Pylon Pendergast, who was an enforcer for the Providence Reds, cut his own vicious teeth at the very same place. Now, I hope this doesn't seem self-serving or show-offy, but it's important to the progression of events of this particular day, or more specifically, afternoon. I was, even at 11, an extremely good hockey player. On skates, I embodied a certain grace that escaped me in virtually every other facet of my early life. I could handle the stick dangerously. And when I was picked to fill out a game against the high school kids, I would attack the net with an aggression that always surprised me. I could never have put it into words, much less understood the transformation that overtook me when I laced up the skates. But looking back the way we all do, I now realize that I became an arrogant little prick on the ice. I always wore a pair of corduroys tucked into my high socks, with the Providence Journal stuffed over my shins. I also always wore my old man's East Providence High School hockey jersey with the number 16 on it. I wore that jersey until I got my own and powered EP to the state title over Mount St. Charles with what would have been a hat trick if the chintzy refs, who were also French-Canadian Christian brothers, by the way, hadn't disallowed the second one when I was clearly behind the line. But that's beside the point. On this particular afternoon, 2 days after Christmas, as I said, I got picked by Denny Cunha to fill out his squad of cronies. Denny and his team were all Portuguese and played the kind of finesse...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.